Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gardening Basics for Dummies, Second Edition, by Stephen A. Frowine, with the editors at the National Gardening Association. Narrated by Stephen R. Thorne. Publisher's note: the print and ebook versions of this book include figures and tables. You will hear the visuals discussed and referenced in this audiobook. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchant ability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. Some of the exercises and dietary suggestions contained in this work may not be appropriate for all individuals, and readers should consult with a physician before commencing any exercise or dietary program. Introduction. Aren't you lucky? You're entering, or are already, part of the most popular and rewarding lifelong hobby that exists, worldwide. Gardening is a common language that knows no national, socioeconomic, or age boundaries. It's a common thread that binds all of us together. Whether you're discussing your outrageous zucchini harvest of the previous year, or sharing your secret tips for prize-winning roses, you've probably found that gardeners have an instant bond, no matter what their level of experience. Because gardening is a huge topic that encompasses a wide field of cultivation interests and disciplines, it's impossible for any one book to cover everything there is to know about gardening. However, when you're armed with the gardening basics, like those presented in this book, you're ready for just about anything that the art and science of gardening can throw at you. Sure, gardening requires some exertion, but it's healthy exercise. It makes you feel a great sense of accomplishment when the flower beds are weeded, the bulbs are planted, and the seeds are sown. It's primal. And reaping the rewards of your labor, by cutting flowers for your dinner party or fresh herbs for your salad, is a special joy that makes the noisy, electronic stimulation that surrounds you, cars, phones, and the like, seem trivial. Gardening fosters a deep satisfaction that nurtures your body and soul. That's why this book, Gardening Basics for Dummies, Second Edition, exists. In addition to giving you basic pointers on how to make your gardening as successful and rewarding as possible, it's a celebration of the art and sheer joy of gardening. About this book. In this book, I've tried to distill my more than 50 years of gardening experience, as well as the knowledge of some of my other gardening friends, because everyone can discover something from each other. I hope you find this book is fun reading. Sometimes gardeners can get way too serious about this pursuit. I've always felt that gardening is supposed to relieve anxiety, not add to it. After all, this is gardening, not brain surgery. Making a mistake, and you will, isn't a big deal. Gardens can recover quickly from our bumbling efforts to care for them. My main mission in this book is to bring you gardening success and the inimitable pleasure that comes from it. It's no fun if all your efforts end up in the compost pile. In this second edition, look for the following: a new chapter on multiplying plants, revised and updated content in nearly every chapter, a new part of tens chapter for northern gardeners. Following the classic For Dummies format, this book gives you the most basic gardening information you need, organized and presented in an easy-to-follow, modular manner. Although you can read from beginning to end, you don't have to. This book can function as a reference work, so you can jump in, find what you need, and get back to your stand of birch trees, or the koi pond, or the garden center, or wherever else you'd like to be. After reading this book, you may not be an expert, but you should be well on your way to taking on most gardening tasks with new confidence. Gardening is part science and part art, and how you mix them up is a very personal thing. After getting a handle on the basics presented here, you can move on to develop your own style and techniques that work best for you. As you advance in gardening, you find that in certain branches of horticulture, like perennials, some trees and shrubs, and orchids, you're confronted with dreaded scientific names, usually Latin, sometimes Greek. People use such names in these plant categories for very legitimate reasons, and you can choose to follow the path to those reasons later. For now, I spare you that step by mostly using common names for the plants throughout this book. When I do provide the scientific name, I give the common plant names first, followed by the botanical name. Even though I sometimes use the word dirt in this book, I must say that I remember one of my horticulture professors admonishing my class when we used this word to describe soil. He always said, "Dirt is what you sweep off the floor. Soil is that miraculous material that you grow plants in." Foolish assumptions. Because you're reading this book, I assume that you're ready to really love gardening. Here are some other things I assume regarding your possible background and interest in gardening. You've seen other folks' gardens that have inspired you, so now you want to bring your own gardening skill to the next level. You're concerned about a fresh and organic diet and want to grow some of your own herbs, fruits, and vegetables. Your lawn is looking on the tattered side, so you want to spruce it up a bit. You've moved to a new place, and the landscaping is non-existent or dreadful, so you want to change it. You love outdoor living, and you want to improve the space around you. You like the idea of gardening, but don't know where to start. You want to know how to multiply your own plants. Icons used in this book. Icons are the cute little pictures that show up in the margins of the book, right next to certain blocks of text, which you'll hear verbalized in the audio edition. Here's what those icons stand for. Remember, this icon points out some major ideas in the book, stuff well worth remembering. I also use this icon to point out garden lingo you may find a bit confusing and help you identify and clarify the most common terms. Tip. The tip icon flags notable gardening information that even experienced gardeners may not know. This info can save you time and frustration. Warning. This icon alerts you to possible problems to watch out for or avoid. These problems may result in injury or, at the very least, a bad gardening experience. Technical stuff. I use this icon to point out stuff that's interesting to read but is not essential to understanding the point I'm making. Where to go from here? A great thing about For Dummies books is that you can start anywhere you want. One part or chapter doesn't depend on any other. For example, if you're interested in growing your own fruit, head right to chapter 18. No need to start anywhere else. That said, if you feel more comfortable getting a basic grounding, so to speak, in gardening before plunging right in, start with chapter 1. If you're re-evaluating or starting your garden from scratch, then any of the other chapters in Part 1 are good places to begin. After that, where you go is really up to you, based on your most pressing gardening needs or pleasures. Of course, keeping your plants alive and making them look their best involves a lot of preparation. You can then read the chapters in Part 1 if you really want your plants to grow, thrive, and look their absolute best. Spending time and effort in preparation at the outset will save you lots of time and effort down the line. If you want to read more, go to dummies.com and search for Gardening Basics for Dummies Cheat Sheet to read a handy cheat sheet that you can refer to again and again. Part 1. Preparing yourself and your garden for planting. In this part, understand the important first steps to fully realizing your garden potential. Examine all the types of flowering plants that add color and interest to your garden, as well as trees, shrubs, and vines that are important garden components. Design and create a landscape that is the envy of your neighborhood, and make a plan that fits your needs, style, and budget, no matter how big or small your property is, and whether it's in the sun or shade. Understand your climate and see how you can extend your growing season. Give your plants what they need to grow and flower to their best. Buy the right tools for the job and know how to use them. Chapter 1. Getting ready for gardening. In this chapter, understanding how plants are named, examining flowering plants, checking out trees, shrubs, and vines, managing your lawn. No matter what your main gardening interest, be it growing vegetables, making your yard colorful with flowers, picking out just the right tree, or aspiring to have the most gorgeous roses on the block, chances are that you care most about the plants. Sure, gardening can also involve landscaping and lawn care. See the chapters in Part 3 of this book. Or being able to grow your own food, Part 4. Or just having a great excuse to play in the dirt, Part 5. But for most people, the plants make everything worthwhile. Okay, yeah, I know. You already know you need to plan and prepare your soil to get your garden going. But you really just want to read about plants right now, right? In that case, the rest of this chapter is devoted to the most basic explanations of the kinds of plants you may encounter in the world of gardening. Later chapters in this book go into much more detail about the various types of plants, trees, bushes, and vines. But here, I help you get a sense of how plants are similar and different. The first step in turning a brown thumb green. First, though, I explain a bit about names. Playing the name game. What's in a name? For gardeners, plenty. Gardening is a blend of horticulture and botany, common names and high science, and the names can get a bit confusing. Whether you're looking at plant anatomy or simply want to know what to call a plant, understanding a bit about naming can help you wade through the garden center aisles, ask better questions, and treat your plants right. Getting used to plant nomenclature. Whenever you're talking about plants, knowing how they're named can help you avoid getting tangled up in the Latin or Greek. Generally, when looking for plants and flowers, you encounter two types of names, botanical and common. Read on for some info on how the naming system works, and then carpe diem, pluck the day. Technical stuff. There is a reason why Latin and Greek are the languages used in naming plants. Latin and Greek have always been the language of scholarship for scientists worldwide. They're unchanging, unlike the modern daily use language. Botanical names. The botanical name is the proper or scientific name of a plant. It consists of two parts and is called a binomial. Bi equals two, Nomial equals name. The species name. The species name is kind of like your own first name, except it comes last in a plant's botanical name. The genus name. The genus name is similar to your family name, except in botanical names, it comes first. For example, in the plant name Hosta undulata, Hosta is the genus name, and undulata is the species name. Hosta describes an entire genus of popular, mostly shade-loving plants named hostas, and undulata describes the type of hosta it is, a hosta with an undulating leaf shape. Technical stuff. The singular and plural for the word species is species. Sometimes the botanical name has a third name, right after the species name, known as the botanical variety. A botanical variety is a member of the same plant species, but looks different enough to warrant its own name, such as Rosa gallica, variety officinalis. Still another botanical name that sometimes comes up is cultivar, short for cultivated variety. Cultivars are usually named by the people who developed or discovered them, and they're often maintained through asexual or vegetative propagation, for example, by cuttings, seed propagation, or the most modern method of raising large numbers of identical plants in test tubes, called tissue culture. In other words, they're cultivated. Humans grow, improve, and develop them. An example is Lychnis coronaria, angel's blush. You can use or modify some of these techniques to make more plants yourself. For more details about how to, see Chapter 10. Remember, a hybrid plant is the result of the cross-pollination between two genetically different plants, usually of the same species, but different varieties. This combination can happen with human intervention, when the object is to make a new or improved plant, or it can occur naturally through bee pollination between two different plants. Botanical names are more common with some types of plants than others. For instance, you frequently run into them with herbaceous plants, trees, and shrubs, but much less so with roses, annuals, and vegetables. You can find botanical names on the labels and in many garden references. Even though botanical names can be a bit intimidating and sometimes a pain to remember, they're much more definitive than common names. They're recognized internationally, so anywhere you are in the world, fellow plant lovers will know what plant you're talking about. Common names. Common names are what you're most likely to encounter when shopping for plants to put in your garden, and they're what you mostly encounter in this book. You can find these names prominently displayed on seed packets or on seedling trays of plants that are for sale. They're kind of like botanical nicknames that gardeners use to describe a certain type of plant without getting into a great amount of detail. For example, the Hosta undulata fits into the genus Hosta, so most gardeners merely refer to these plants under the common name of Hostas. And you may know that Hemerocallis is actually the genus name for the common daylily, but chances are that most gardeners you encounter just call them daylilies. The biggest problem with common names is that the same plant can have many different common names, depending on what part of the United States or the world you live in. Sharing names with distant relatives. If you want to be absolutely sure of the plant you're buying, then remember that the botanical or scientific name, including the cultivar name, is the most exact one. Some common names, like common basil, are very specific. All common basil has the same genus and species, Osmum basilicum. However, a common name like daisy is so general that it may not be very helpful. This term can apply to plants very faintly related, found in various genera, genuses. For instance, a daisy can be an African daisy, Arctotis or Gerbera, Dahlberg daisy, Disodia tenuiloba, English daisy, Bellis perennis, painted daisy, Chrysanthemum coccineum, Shasta daisy, Leucanthemum superbum, and many others. If you're shopping by common names, read labels to make sure this particular kind of plant can grow for you. Anatomy 101, Naming Plant Parts. Beyond recognizing the names of plants, knowing the various parts of plants is also useful. Figure 1-1 shows a nice, healthy perennial plant with the basic parts displayed. Botanists use many more descriptive and detailed names for plant parts, but you have enough to remember without getting further confused. You probably already know most of the common ones, but keep these parts in mind because you need to know them to understand some of the things I discuss in the rest of this book and to speak the language with fellow gardeners. In the figure, the taproot, not all plants have this, is the main root of the plant. The stolon, or runner, is a horizontal stem that spreads underground, sending up more plants as it goes. Many ground covers, pachysandra, ivy, ice plant, operate this way, as anyone who has tried to tug up a patch well knows. Remember, propagate is a term commonly used in horticulture to describe the process of reproducing or multiplying plants. I discuss it in more detail in Chapter 10. When you know the parts of plants and the difference between all the plant names you run into, you may be ready to get the lowdown on the types of plants out there. Beautifying with flowers and foliage. Flowers are often the first thing that comes to mind when people think of gardening, and the first thing people plan to grow when they want to beautify their surroundings. Flowers are marvelous because they come in a vast array of sizes, colors, and shapes. See Figure 1-2. And no matter where you live, at least one kind of flowering plant can grow there. Even the volcanic crater of Haleakala on the island of Maui is home to a flowering plant, the rare silver sword. Flowers are more than merely the beautiful display they put on, however. If you know the different types of flowers out there, you can take full advantage of displaying them in your own garden. Read on for info on annuals and perennials, as well as a bit on bulbs and roses. Amazing annuals. You may already know what annuals are without realizing that you know. These beauties are the flowers, arrayed in flats and pots, for sale every spring down at the garden center. Everything from geraniums to impatiens to marigolds. You bring them home and plunk them in the ground, and they get right to work, delivering pretty much continuous color all summer long. When fall comes, they start to slow down. Some may even go to seed. Cold weather eventually causes them to wither and die. Game over. That is, unless you live in a frost-free climate. In this case, your annuals may become perennials. For the brief time annuals are growing and pumping out flowers, you get a lot of bang for your buck. A great deal of selection and breeding refinements over the years have made these plants totally reliable. They're full of exuberant energy and hard to kill. Indeed, some of them keep blooming their cheery heads off even when you neglect them. They provide reliable garden color, even as perennials cycle in and out of bloom. Some gardeners have been known to sneer at good old annuals. They're boring. They're too perky. They're plastic plants. These folks may or may not have a point, but hey, annuals are hard to beat if you want a colorful garden. In the end, the main drawback of annuals is economic. You have to buy new ones every spring. If you're planting a wide area, running out to buy more year in and year out can get expensive. Time may also be an issue for you. You may grow sick and tired of getting down on your hands and knees and replanting. If you're getting to that point, consider a longer-term investment, planting perennials. You can use annuals to fill in an entire flower bed. This popular use is why some places call annuals bedding plants. To add to container displays, in pots, window boxes, patio planter boxes, and more. To fill a hanging basket. To edge a walkway. To insert reliable color in a perennial bed. To decorate a vegetable and herb garden. To cover over, or at least distract from, a fading spring bulb display. To add summer color to your flower beds when the perennials are done blooming. To fill in places where perennial plants haven't filled in yet. The added advantage of covering ground so opportunistic weeds can't move in. If the info you want on annuals isn't in the upcoming sections, you can get an in-depth look in Chapter 6. Caring for and feeding annuals. Luckily, taking proper care of annuals is not rocket science. For the most part, annuals are easygoing because they're bred to be quite tough and durable. Many can withstand some neglect and still be productive. Not that I recommend ignoring them. Remember, without a doubt, water is an annual's number one need. All that lusty growth and continuous flowering requires fuel. A thirsty plant can't sustain the show for long. Regular, deep soakings are best because they reliably supply water to the roots, which leads to a stress-free life of consistent growth and bud and bloom production. Note that a drying-out plant favors its roots, and to a lesser extent, its leaves, in a bid for survival, automatically jettisoning its water-hogging buds and petals. Note that annuals grown in pots, hanging baskets, or window boxes dry out much faster than the ones grown in the ground. See Chapter 4 for more info on watering. You can't deny that regular doses of plant food or fertilizer significantly boost your annuals. Make sure you apply it according to directions. For best flowering, fertilize every 6 weeks with a granular or organic fertilizer, or add a water-soluble fertilizer to your sprinkling can every week or so. The leaves become healthier and greener, and you end up with more buds and flowers. Chapter 4 contains information on fertilizer as well. The rather unromantic term of deadheading simply refers to the practice of pinching off or cutting off spent flowers. Your annuals look nicer when you do this, of course, but removing the flowers also serves another purpose. It thwarts the plant from the energy-intensive process of producing seeds, and the plant responds by diverting its energy back into making more flowers. Raising annuals from seed. Of course, you can raise annuals from seed, which is the most economical approach, especially if you want to grow large quantities for a display garden. Some are simpler to grow than others. Annuals with very small seeds, like snapdragons and begonias, are a bit more of a challenge because you need to start them indoors in a bright windowsill or under fluorescent lights. Just buy the seed packets in late winter and sow them in flats or pots. Particular directions are always on the back of the packets. Raise the seedlings indoors until spring weather comes and the soil warms up and all danger of frost is past. Then move the plants outside. Some annuals are so fast-growing that you can sprinkle their seeds on good soil in late spring, right outside, and they'll quickly sprout and grow. This group includes popular ones like zinnias, marigolds, and nasturtiums. This process may require you to do some thinking at some point, but otherwise, it's dead easy. Again, consult the back of the seed packet for details. One advantage to this tack is that you can grow some more unconventional or rare annuals. It certainly makes for a more interesting garden. Refer to Chapter 10 for more about growing plants from seed. Beholding a one-time show. The very definition of an annual, a plant that goes from seed to flowering to death in one season, completing its entire life cycle in short order, states that annuals are a one-time show. When it's over, it's over. Except when it's not. If you garden in a mild climate, many annuals merely slow down for the winter, but survive. Snapdragons and many salvias are examples. If you garden in a cold climate, you can try digging up some favorites or bringing potted annuals inside. Keep them in a non-freezing place, out of direct sunlight, and let them rest. Cut back all spent growth. Start reviving them with water and plant food when the spring returns. However, if, despite your best efforts, your wintered-over annuals don't return to their former glory the following spring, accept their fate, pull them out, and replace them with new ones. Some of the annuals, like marigolds, sunflowers, and zinnias, reseed or self-sow themselves so they'll sprout and grow plants the following spring when the ground warms. Depending on how aggressively they do this can be a good or bad thing. Annuals that aren't really annuals. False annuals are plants with tropical origins, or ones whose parents hail from the tropics, which means that they're actually perennial, more long-lived somewhere, somewhere warmer, somewhere far away, like Costa Rica or Mexico. These pseudo-annuals, sometimes called tender perennials, can, at least in theory, be kept going over the winter and live to dress up your garden again next year. Examples of these tropical visitors include the coleus, geranium, impatiens, salvia, snapdragon, and wax begonia. Meanwhile, biennials are plants that only live for 2 years. They grow their foliage and roots the first year, and then flower the following year, and then die. The most common examples are Canterbury bells, forget-me-nots, foxgloves, hollyhocks, pansies, stock, and verbascum, mullein. They frequently reseed themselves, so some gardeners let them go to seed to ensure future plants. Most garden centers helpfully start these plants for you the season before or in early winter, so they're usually sold as annuals and flower the first year that you plant them. Perennial plants. For many gardeners, going from growing annuals to exploring perennials seems to be a natural progression. But remember that you don't have to choose. You can grow both, and indeed your garden is likely to be the better for the diversity. So, what exactly are perennials? One gardener jokingly defined a perennial as a plant that, had it lived, would have bloomed again the next year. For the most part, they're long-lived, herbaceous, non-woody plants, flowers and herbs mainly. How long they last depends on the plant and the conditions in your garden. But these plants certainly last longer than annuals. A typical perennial emerges in the spring, grows, and often produces flowers and seeds as the seasons progress from spring to summer to fall, and then slows down or dies back in winter. But the plant doesn't actually die. It just rests. The following spring, your perennial returns in glory to repeat the cycle. Unlike annuals, you don't have to replant perennials every year. Once should be enough. Well, if you choose wisely and take good care of your perennials, you ought to get many good years out of them. Eventually, though, Some perennials run out of steam. Their growth gets crowded, and they don't seem to flower as well. At this time, you can dig them out and replace them. Or you can divide them, perhaps discarding the tired-out center or mother plant, and replant well-rooted bits for a fresh new start. Here are some of the many uses of perennials. Creating a colorful bed or border. Filling an island bed, an isolated, self-contained garden like an island in a sea of lawn. Mixing them with annuals to assure summer-long color. Edging a walkway, patio, pool area, or deck. Interplanting them with roses, annuals, or other ornamental shrubs to provide year-round interest. Dressing up an area that was formerly lawn. For the nitty-gritty details on perennials, check out Chapter 7. If you just want the basics, read on. In on the ground floor. Ground covers. Low-growing perennial plants may be handy in a flower border, near the front where they won't be blocked from view, or as an edging. But they have another, very practical use. You can plant entire areas with them, and they can form a low-care carpet. Ground covers are problem solvers for difficult-to-landscape areas, such as shady areas, including under trees where lawn won't grow, or areas where you don't want to or can't easily mow, such as slopes or embankments. Some favorite ground covers include Agica, Candy Tuft, Creeping Phlox, Epimedium, Hosta, Ivy, Lamium, Lily of the Valley, Pachysandra, Sweet Woodruff, Verbena, and Vinca. For details on ground covers, turn to Chapter 14. Caring for and feeding perennials. The water needs of perennials vary. Some are moisture lovers, others are drought tolerant, and many are somewhere in the middle. Do your homework when choosing plants, not just on what they prefer, but on which ones are suitable to the growing conditions in your yard and climate. Otherwise, you'll be jumping through hoops trying to please them. Chapter 2 can help you get a grip on how to plan your garden. One generalization is possible, though. Nothing makes newly planted perennials feel more welcome than plentiful water does. The perennials have gone from a sheltered and confining life in a pot to the wide world of your garden. And water helps sustain the roots and encourages them to establish themselves and expand into their new home. Many perennials, like most people, enjoy being fed. They respond by growing more robustly and producing more flowers. You're fine with a general all-purpose garden fertilizer applied according to the label directions during the height of the growing season. Don't feed your perennials as fall approaches and growth naturally begins to slow. You don't want them producing a fresh new flush of growth that soon gets nipped by a frost. For some general info on fertilizing, see Chapter 4. I have to admit that fertilizing the majority of perennials isn't mandatory. If you plant them in soil that suits them and do your homework when choosing the plants, they may do just fine without it. Good, organically rich soil and good growing conditions and regular water can sustain healthy, hardy perennial growth for quite some time. Fertilizing merely supplies a boost in these cases. Looking at lifespan. The life cycle of a perennial depends on various factors, notably the type of plant and whether it's happy in your garden. But you can certainly expect to get a minimum of 2 years and a maximum of a decade out of the vast majority of perennials. For best results, of course, take good care of them. Remember, most perennials are slow starters. During their first year in your garden, they tend to invest in developing a good root system. Be patient. After that's established, they grow and expand, and the flower show gets better with each passing year. You can hurry things along by fertilizing regularly during the height of the growing season. See Chapter 4 for fertilizing details, and get a head start by planting in the fall. Considering fall planting. If you shop for perennials in late summer and get them in the ground a good 6 weeks or more before the first frost, those plants will definitely have a head start over their spring-planted counterparts. In fall, the soil is still warm and welcoming, and drenching fall rains can help water in the new kids. Depending on the severity of your winter, cutting back any new growth and mulching when winter is just around the corner may be good ideas. Tip: most perennials sold in the late summer or fall have been grown for an entire season, so they're generally bigger plants than what you'll find for sale in the spring. Also, they're many times on sale, because the grower doesn't want to overwinter them, so you get a good deal. For much more on perennials, please turn to Chapter 7. Bulbs and roses. Bulbs, which store their food underground, are a richly varied group of plants. The best-known ones, like tulips and daffodils, are spring-flowering. But these plants represent only the tip of the iceberg. Many others, like dahlias and lilies, are summer bloomers. What they all have in common is that they're easy to grow and produce plenty of flowers. Just provide them a sunny, well-drained spot, stand back, and let them do their thing. See Chapter 8 for info on bulbs. Although bulbs are quite popular, roses are America's favorite flowers for many reasons. They epitomize romance and come in an impressive range of flower colors, not to mention their inimitable delicious fragrances. Lucky for us, modern rose breeders have worked their wonders on this plant to produce roses that are not only stunningly beautiful, but also tough as nails. Roses are no longer the wimps that gardeners loved to think about growing but were afraid to try because of the reputation for being a magnet to every known plant disease and insect pest. Today's varieties are also available in a range of plant habits, from upright to bush forms to those that are ground-hugging. Chapter 9 can fill you in on growing roses. Gardening for your dining pleasure. Increasingly, for many gardeners, growing food is the real reason for gardening. There really isn't quite anything like the feeling of satisfaction a gardener gets from nurturing and encouraging a tomato plant to put forth the most gorgeous and delicious tomatoes imaginable, or harvesting a healthy and tasty fruit from a tree planted right in the front yard. And if you like to cook, there's nothing quite like working with and eating freshly harvested produce that you know exactly what chemicals have been added or not. Food-bearing plants come in all shapes, sizes, and types, from annuals and perennials to trees and bushes, to vines that creep along the ground or climb to impressive heights when given the right support. Chapter 15 gives you the information you need to get started on growing your own vegetables. Chapter 16 is devoted to herbs and how you can grow them to enhance the dishes that come out of your kitchen. Working with woody or viney plants. When planning which plants to grow in your garden, check out native plants. In general, they're easy to grow because they have been long adapted to your area, are frequently drought-tolerant, and are usually low-maintenance. Check out which plants are native to your area at nwf.org/native-plant-finder/plants. Woody plants consist of shrubs, some vines, and trees. This group of plants is probably a more important garden element than annuals and perennials, simply because of the space that woody plants take up over the long term. They serve as kind of the bones of your garden. You may have inherited some trees and shrubs when you moved into your present home, or you may be considering replacing what you have, or installing some new ones. Whatever you're thinking, choose and act wisely. Allow these bigger plants the elbow room, the deeper prepared soil, and the light they may need. The reason trees, shrubs, and some vines are called woody plants is that the bulk of their stems and branches are, well, woody, not herbaceous. This growth doesn't wither or die back in the wintertime as it does with herbaceous plants. Yes, the leaves, flowers, fruits, berries, and seeds may fade and fall off, but the rest of the plant abides. And with each passing year, the main stem or trunk grows another layer thicker, and the plant may add additional branches or woody stems. No wonder woody plants are considered a more or less permanent, and certainly substantial, parts of a home landscape. Shrubs. You may choose flowering or evergreen shrubs. Both kinds are worthwhile in different ways. Just bear in mind that flowering shrubs tend to have a fairly brief period of glory, and then you're left with only foliage, so pick a shrub whose foliage you like. Good fall color and attractive or exfoliating bark, leaves, and/or berries may also be a factor in your decision. On the other hand, evergreen shrubs, whether broadleaf or needled, are valuable for long-term, consistent green color, sometimes offer attractive flowers, and in many cases, a denser growing profile. Favorite shrubs for home landscapes include flowering, althea, deciduous azalea, broom, butterfly bush, daphne, deutzia, elderberry, flowering quince, forsythia, fothergilla, hibiscus, hydrangea, itia, lilac, mock orange, ninebark, privet, red buckeye, red twig dogwood, smokebush, spirea, sweet shrub, sweet spire, various viburnums, weigela, winterberry, and witch hazel. Broadleaf evergreen, with spring flowers and more or less evergreen foliage. Andromeda, Acuba, boxwood, camellia, cotoneaster, evergreen abelia, gardenia, holly, laurel, lacothaway, mahonia, manzanita, mountain laurel, nandina, oleander, rhododendron, and rock rose. Evergreen, arborvitae, boxwood, euonymus, some cedars, some false cypresses, hemlock, holly, juniper, laurel, some pines, some spruces, and yew. Take a look at some of the roles shrubs can play. Foundation planting, around the base of your house to add architectural interest, insulation, and security. Boundary and hedge plantings, possibly in addition to or in lieu of fencing. Thorny ones, including shrubby roses, are popular as living fences. Individual, solo spots of color, specimen plants. Mixed border citizens for more architectural interest. Have a mixture of shrubs, or have a mixture of one type of shrub and roses or perennials or vines, or all of these. Backdrops for a flower border. Entryway, poolside, deckside, or privacy plantings. As food and shelter for songbirds. For much more on shrubs, please turn to Chapter 13. Warning. Some shrubs can be extremely invasive, and in fact are even against the law to plant in some cities or states. Some that you should avoid are Amur honeysuckle, autumn olive, barberries, burning bush, bush honeysuckle, common gorse, buckthorn, and multiflora rose. For a complete list, check out invasiveplantatlas.org/shrubs.cfm. Trees. Trees can raise your property value, improve air quality, prevent erosion, lower your air conditioning costs with welcome shade, and provide a handy support for your hammock. Not too shabby, eh? For most home gardeners, trees in the landscape are often already present, but need care and pruning to look good and remain healthy. Or you may be shopping for one or more ornamental or fruiting trees to add. As with shrubs, your options include deciduous, ones that drop their leaves each fall. They may flower and fruit or have berries or seed pods, and evergreen, with leaves or needles that remain year-round. Favorite trees for home landscapes include flowering and deciduous, catalpa, dogwood, dove tree, golden chain tree, horse chestnut, magnolia, redbud, serviceberry, silk tree, snowbell, and stewartia. Shade trees: ash, basswood, beech, catalpa, elm, ginkgo, honey locust, Kentucky coffee tree, linden, locust, various maples, various oaks, sourwood, sweet gum, and tupelo. Evergreen: arborvitae, cedar, cypress, false cypress, fir, hemlock, juniper, Norfolk Island pine, spruce, and yew. Fruit and nut trees: almond, apple, apricot, avocado, cherry, chestnut, citrus, crabapple, fig, filbert, hazelnut, juneberry, loquat, mulberry, nectarine, olive, pawpaw, peach, pear, pecan, plum, quince, and walnut. Roles trees can play involve things like shade, privacy, including noise reduction, grandeur and substance in the landscape, food, fruits, berries, and nuts for you and your family, as well as for wildlife. Decorative beauty due to foliage, including fall color. Shelter and food for birds and other wild creatures. Warning: referring to any trees as terrible may be heresy, but some trees can cause real problems, like producing huge quantities of seeds that sprout all over where they aren't wanted, and messy seed heads or fruit that are a pain to clean up. Some trees produce soft, weak growth that results in limbs breaking and falling on your house. Some of the undesirables are box elder, sheds fruit and twigs, plus shelters yucky box elder bugs, Bradford pear, heavy seeding and splitting branches, ginkgo, stinky fruit, silver maple, splitting branches, sweet gum, nuisance spiny balls, and tree of heaven, weak, weedy growth. For checking out other invasive trees, refer to invasive.org/species/trees.cfm. For much more information on trees in general, please turn to Chapter 12. For info on fruit and nut trees, check out Chapter 18. Vines. Annual vines, like morning glory, nasturtium, moonflower, and so on, aren't woody. But vines, woody or not, can be a substantial presence in your landscape. Vines like to grow upward, though some need assistance in terms of occasional judicious pruning and/or trimming, guidance and/or support. Some vines are valued mainly for their lush foliage. Others flower and fruit with attractive seed heads or berries by fall. All factors that naturally add to their appeal and affect placement and maintenance. Choose vines based on whether and when you want these extra color-contributing features. Also, when purchasing, be sure to inquire about predicted mature size. Some of my favorite vines for home landscapes that are both attractive and have bird and wildlife appeal are bougainvillea, clematis, climbing hydrangea, climbing roses, creeping fig, Dutchman's pipe, grape, honeysuckle, jasmine, kiwi, mandevilla. Roles vines can play include cloaking or disguising a fence, especially if it's unattractive, or just use vines to make it into a more substantial barrier. Climbing a trellis that's either against a wall or fence or put out in the open, if well supported. Covering a gazebo to give shade and privacy, as well as beauty. Decorating a pillar, arbor, or pergola, adding shade and beauty, as well as making a major contribution to your garden landscape. Adding extra vertical color to your garden, which is especially nice if your garden is small or you want to give it a feeling of enclosure. Draping over an outbuilding or shed, an old or dead tree trunk, or another larger structure in need of some softening or disguise. Providing flowers and edible fruit for decorating and eating. Note: even ridiculously strong vines can't help you swing from tree to tree, namely because they're attached to the ground and not so attached at the top. If you really don't want to stay grounded, Chapter 19 can give you info on installing a tire swing. For much more information on vines, please turn to Chapter 14. I address climbing roses in more detail in Chapter 9. Warning: some vines are rogues. They may smother or pull down supports, provide a haven for porch or trellis-munching insects, shed too much, or produce many unwanted seedlings. A few to watch out for are akebia, Chinese wisteria, English ivy, Japanese honeysuckle, kudzu, Oriental bittersweet, porcelain vine, trumpet creeper, and winter creeper. I've seen some of these vines used very effectively in certain circumstances. Just be careful and know they can outgrow their welcome. For more info on invasive vines, check out invasive.org/species/vines.cfm. The world is flat. Caring for your lawn. Some gardeners love lawn care. Others think it's just a necessary chore. Whichever way you feel, one thing can't be denied. Lawns, even small ones, can define a garden. They frame and provide a backdrop for all your other plants. If your lawn looks shabby, unfortunately, the rest of your garden creations just don't look as good. I appreciate that everyone these days is pressed for time and can't spend the time on manicuring their turf like golf course managers do. So in Chapter 11, I give you the basic, nitty-gritty information so that your lawn can do you proud without taking too much time away from the rest of your creative garden pursuits. Chapter 2: Creating a Landscape That You'll Love. In this chapter, working with what you already have, deciding on your garden style, staying within your budget, setting up your garden plans, hiring a professional. Consider your ideal garden. Perhaps you know you want a handsome woodland shade garden, but what'll it look like? Or maybe you know you want a sunny cottage garden, but what's your vision? Getting to this point in your garden planning is a bit like shopping for a blue shirt. You know you want a shirt, and you know you want it to be blue, but you still have plenty of options. Now's the time to narrow in on your target. By assessing your gardening wants and needs, and what you already have available for your garden, you can come up with the best garden for you. In this chapter, I lead you through the processes that can help you clarify your vision, and I explain how you can start making your dream garden a reality. Creating a garden can be compared to writing a book. First, you start words, individual plants, then you put these words into sentences, plant combinations. Next, you put these phrases into paragraphs, sections of the garden. And finally, these paragraphs turn into chapters and a book, your entire garden. Remember, don't be intimidated by this process. No garden is created in a day. Take your time. Enjoy the process. Designing and creating a garden isn't static. It constantly evolves. There is no one right way to do this. And don't be self-judgmental. It doesn't matter what anyone else thinks. After all, it's your garden. Evaluating what you already have. Observation. That's the very first step. Forget for a moment what's growing in your neighbor's yards or other home landscapes around town that you see and may covet. Take a broader view. It's all part of the assessing process, a process that can lead you to a gorgeous, successful garden of your own. And don't forget that the garden is part of your yard in general. If you incorporate your garden plans into an overall plan for your yard, the yard itself can become a beautiful extension of the garden. Identifying and spending some time analyzing what you already have is an important step in planning. After all, every yard is different, and therefore presents a gardening challenge. You may be surprised, as you ponder, to discover that you can work quite well with what you already have, making seemingly minor changes to major effect. The following sections help you examine where to start, recognize what issues you have, and maximize what features your yard has. Looking at the big picture. Here are the basic things to look for that affect your overall gardening plans. The following issues directly influence your planting decisions. Local climate. Over the course of a calendar year, is your area's climate dry or damp? Generally sunny or generally rainy? Do your winters or summers slow everything down or bring plant growth to a temporary halt? The answers to these questions can tell you which plants are likely to grow easily and which ones may require some extra help. See Chapter 3 for info about plant hardiness zones and how they affect your growing space. Type of soil in your yard. Consider the natural soil in your area. Is it rather sandy, clay, loamy, rich, crumbly, and dark, acidic, alkaline? Does it drain rainwater away quickly, or does moisture puddle and linger for days? The answers can help you understand which plants will thrive and which ones will need soil improvements. If you really don't have any idea, a simple soil test is a good idea. See Chapter 4. Plants native to your area or already growing in your yard. Finding out which plants, trees, shrubs, grasses, flowers, are native or perform well in your general area, either by observing or by asking around, can further fill you in on what kind of growing conditions you've been dealt. Zoning restrictions. Before you get too far along, make sure you're aware of any landscaping or building restrictions or regulations that your HOA or city might have. In general, front yard plantings that are visible from the street typically have more restrictions than backyard plantings or structures. A good neighbor. Let your neighbors know of your plans or additions, especially if your plans affect their views or privacy. And here are some structural considerations for your garden. Permanence of big structures. Okay, the house stays. The garage and shed, too, although maybe you can move or replace the shed. What about shade trees? Can and should you cut any of them down, or at least prune them? Big branches may be a hazard, and letting more light into a garden is often welcome. Walkways. Changing the path of foot traffic if it's currently in the way of your garden space is hard, but not impossible. So take a hard look and be honest. If you add or replace a walking surface, the yard can look immediately nicer and your garden spot may be neatly outlined. Remember, options for installing a path include gravel, brick, flagstone, and other paving materials. Wandering paths look nicer and slow down footsteps, but pathways should actually lead somewhere if you want people to use them. Wider paths also slow people down and encourage them to enjoy their surroundings, your beautiful garden. Desire for privacy or shelter. Good fences can make good neighbors, and materials make all the difference. Big, substantial wooden fences do block street noise and unsightly views, but may also create shade and look unfriendly. A lighter or more open design may be better, perhaps softened with a flowering, climbing plant. An alternative is living fences of hedges or an informal line of bushes, evergreen or deciduous, with or without fruit and flowers. Turn to Chapter 13 for information. Work with what you have to improve your fence's look, or vow to install or replace it with something nicer. Identifying problems and restrictions. There are certain classic gardening problems, and thankfully, myriad solutions. Don't ever feel overwhelmed. Picking out an area to work on and improve and concentrating your efforts can buoy your spirits, and then you can move on to another concern. My advice is to start first with an area you have the time and money to fix up, preferably an area you want to start enjoying sooner rather than later. The main point is to take action. Address the big issues now, and you'll definitely feel well on your way to a more beautiful, enjoyable garden. Read on for some basic problems and possible solutions. You have too much shade. A yard or garden space with a lot of shade is often lamented as forcing too many limitations on gardeners. Never fear. This problem is often much easier to remedy than you may think, usually just by pruning some trees and bushes. 1. Go out with a clippers and/or a small pruning saw to remove all non-negotiable branches and twigs. Anything obviously dead or diseased, particularly the lower branches of thick trees. 2. Go on to thinning, taking out growth that's rubbing against other branches or crowding the interior of a plant. 3. For anything you can't handle, call in a certified arborist or a tree company. Warning. If you aren't sure you can do it yourself, don't do it. Tree work can be very dangerous. You need the services of a tree company if you decide to take out an entire tree or large limbs. Check with local authorities. In some areas, you need permission to cut down trees. In the end, more sun, more light, and more air. A whole new yard. If a tree is in your neighbor's yard, but the unwanted branches come over into yours, talk to them about removing the branches or even the whole tree. When a shade tree affects your yard and your neighbors, work out splitting the arborist bill to remove or prune. It's only fair. If you decide to use a certified arborist, get references. Make sure the arborist is insured and bonded. Tip. If a more permanent structure, such as a house or fence, causes your shade problem, then you may still have more planting options available than you think. Review the chapters in parts 2, 3, and 4 for a variety of ideas on how to grow in the shade. Tip: regardless of whether bushes and shrubs are a shade problem, you should prune them to remove some or all of the offending thicket to keep your garden, and yard in general, looking good. Try an early spring pruning foray. This is also the time to do drastic chopping back, say, if you want to reduce a hedge's height. Cut no more than one-third at a time. You can prune again next season. Spring pruning is preferred because plants are surging into new growth and they'll be better able to recover from cutting back. Fall pruning can be a mistake because it may inspire fresh new growth that then gets damaged by cold weather and or frost. For flowering shrubs and trees, always prune them right after they flower, before they develop flower buds for the following season. Otherwise, you'll be removing next year's flowers. You have too much sun. If your garden space is sunnier than you'd prefer, the quick solution is to add human-made items. Try an umbrella or two, a pergola, arbor, or an outdoor tent. For the long term, you can make a planting plan with shade trees, see Chapter 12, and vines, see Chapter 14, that cover trellises and other structures. Your yard is too big. Here are three good ways to reduce that maintenance-demanding, water-hogging lawn and create ideal spaces for gardening. Make garden beds around the sides of the yard, widening or extending them as you can. Alternatively, create what landscapers call island beds, which are flat or mounded beds, in any shape and size you like, in the middle of a lawn. Add large, sprawling structures that take up a lot of yard space. Some ways to do this are pathways, a terrace, patio, or deck, a pool, swimming, or ornamental, a potting shed, or gazebo. Adding garden beds around these structures really spruces things up. Fence in or otherwise enclose individual garden spaces, like rose or herb gardens, around your yard. The fence can be an artificial fence made of wood or metal, or it can be made of hedges, ornamental grasses, or trellises overhung with vines. Use your imagination. Remember, fences offer so many possibilities. They create private spaces and add a whole new vertical element that you can festoon with vining fruits, veggies, climbing roses, annuals, or perennials. For example, consider adding a white metal fence festooned with blue morning glories, or a wooden one with a blooming rose bush swooning over it. Your yard is too little. A small yard can seem bigger, more welcoming, and a lot more charming when you employ a few basic gardening techniques. With these methods, you can transform your cozy little yard into the garden of your dreams. Soften the edges of your lawn so they don't seem so imposing. If you have a fence, you can paint the fence a bright color. Dark colors heighten the sense of constriction. Add lush vines or climbing roses. Adorn the fence with potted plants. Create a varied layering effect. That is, position different plant types and textures above and behind one another, stepping up to the edges of your yard. Some gardeners literally display a combination of in-ground and potted plants on and around a rack or stepladder. Add a focal point. Ideas include a statue, a small fountain, or one spectacular pot or urn with a big, dramatic plant or showy combination of plants. A focal point draws attention away from the close boundaries. the soil isn't the type or quality you want. Every gardener wishes for beautiful, well-drained, rich, black garden loam, rich, dark soil. But for most folks, that's a pipe dream. Good soil is usually made by the gardener and rarely comes with the property. More often than you may think, poor soil thwarts gardening plans. People just forget or underestimate the importance of good soil to plant in. Tip: to tackle this problem, consider doing one of the following. Try growing only those types of plants proven to work in your soil. See what the neighbors are growing in their gardens. Check with the local nursery for the best plants to grow in your area. Dig into the soil and mix in the materials you want, sort of like making cake batter, only more work. Work to change and improve the soil. Some folks use a rototiller for this job, but it has its drawbacks. A rototiller can pulverize the soil to such a degree that it destroys its texture. It also has other drawbacks. It brings weed seeds and bits to the surface where they begin to grow, and it damages the habitat of helpful soil organisms, from barely visible creatures that help break down organic matter to helpful earthworms. A rototiller can be useful for doing the initial soil or sod busting, but after that initial work, forks and shovels will probably be your best bet. Just remember to add plenty of organic matter, like compost or composed pine bark, as you can. See Chapter 5 for more on rototillers. Remember to work down to a depth of 6 to 8 inches, 15 to 20 centimeters, for most garden plants. Less for shallow-rooted grass, more for trees and shrubs. Too many weeds. You can attack these unwelcome plants any time of the year, but you'll make faster progress if you start in late fall or early spring and thwart them before or just as they're sprouting. Use a hoe, smother weeds with plastic or mulch, or carefully use an herbicide or some combination of these tactics. Then, in midsummer, make sure you don't let weeds go to seed. Pull them, mow them down, and discard them outside your garden to keep them from coming back. There is a saying that nature abhors a vacuum. After you get weeds out, don't leave empty space to tempt more weeds to move in. Overplant, or cover the area as soon as possible. If the weeds go to seed, your weed problem has just gotten much worse. Weeding after a rain, when the ground is damp and soft, makes it much easier and more effective. Weeding can almost be therapeutic. Taking advantage of your yard's assets. Every garden space has its strengths and its good spots, if only you look. And some of the problems I mention in earlier sections can actually be benefits if you see them that way. You can save yourself a lot of time, effort, and grief by identifying these types of spots and working with what you have rather than knocking yourself out to impose an ambitious or inappropriate plan upon your garden space. Go with the flow, in other words. Refer to Part 2 for more on the specific types. Here are a few examples of conditions you may find within your garden space and how to handle them. Sunny days. Many plants, especially those with colorful flowers, love bright sunshine. Rejoice and be glad you have it. Then go shopping for a wide range of bright and lively plants. Have fun with color combinations. No combinations are wrong, as long as you like them. Full sun also affords you the opportunity to grow many vegetables, herbs, fruits, and water lilies. The dark side. If your lot in life is shade, don't fret. Consider it a gift, a chance to create a cool, soothing, even enchanting oasis. Without direct blasts from the hot sun, plants in a shady area look fresher and crisper for far longer. Wilting and withering in the heat aren't issues. Colors don't get washed out. And not only do flowers last longer, but they also add sparkle and definition. For ideas, read the shade gardening parts of chapters 6 and 7. Dry conditions. Instead of knocking yourself out trying to provide water for thirsty plants, seek out ones that prosper in drier growing conditions. A nursery that offers native plants and good-looking cultivars of the same is a good place to start. You don't have to grow only cacti and succulents, though you should check out the amazingly wide range of colors and shapes before you decide not to. Lots of exciting dry-ground, drought-tolerant plants are available to gardeners these days. This type of garden has its own name: xeriscaping. You can find plenty of examples of these gardens online. Water. If your yard's soggy or boggy, stop neglecting the area to weeds or trying to dry it out. Instead, grow plants that relish damp ground. Loads of good-looking choices, large and small, tall and ground covering, flowering and foliage, are available. Try red twig dogwood, red maples, skunk cabbage, Japanese primroses, or, for real fun, go for some carnivorous plants like pitcher plants, sundews, or Venus flytraps. Reclaiming the good garden hiding in your yard. Improving on what you already have in your yard is a quick and easy way to start enjoying a good garden. Timing is often key. That is, make your move at the right time, and the project will be less work and will yield faster results. If the project seems overwhelming, by all means, find or hire help. Hiring someone to do a job that you aren't up to is usually much cheaper than going to a chiropractor if you overdo it. To improve a flower bed, rake out all debris, remove all weeds, and add soil amendments in late fall or early spring. Plan what will go in, and remember to avoid overcrowding and to allow for each plant's mature size. Last but not least, mulch the bed to retain moisture and thwart weeds, so the bed will hopefully never get out of hand again. You can reclaim a vegetable garden, even if it's full of weeds. Chances are that the garden still has fairly good soil. Get weeds and debris out of there in fall or early spring. Repair or install edging and/or fencing, and then dig in some organic matter for good measure. This step's easier now, before you add plants. Then cover the entire area with black plastic or a thick layer of mulch until you're ready to plant to keep out digging critters and thwart a resurgence of weeds. Getting ideas for your garden space. After you take inventory of your garden space and yard in general, consider what sort of garden you want. Before you get bogged down in choosing plants and deciding where to plant them, think in broad terms once again. How do you want to use your garden? What are your needs and expectations? Naming your goals can help you further clarify the details of your plans. Here, I detail a few garden ideas that may interest you. Gardening with the kids in mind. If you have young children of your own, or if kids are always visiting, plan for them and their antics. A flower border of precious perennials, some of them delicately supported by stakes, are in constant danger of being trampled if kids ride bikes or play rousing games of soccer nearby. Although placing your raised bed vegetable garden right in the center of a sunny lawn may be logical, figure out whether the kids' fun and games can work around it, or whether the kids will be running through it. As parents everywhere know, The key to lowering your frustration level is being flexible. Sight the perennials way at the back of the lawn area if you must. Shield flowers with a fence or picnic table or living barrier, such as a line of shrubs or berry bushes. Locate that vegetable garden more off to the side, and so on. You get the idea. With kids' short attention spans and wish for quick gratification, it's unlikely that you'll be able to get the children to help you dig up a new planting area, nor would it be safe or advisable to have them help with pruning projects. But you have plenty of other ways to build your kids' interest in gardening. Raise some easy-to-grow plants for kids. Favorites include radishes, green beans, pole beans on a teepee so kids can have a fort inside, nasturtiums, morning glories, mini pumpkins, and sunflowers. Plant things kids love to harvest, whether vegetables or flowers for bouquets. Just make sure you supervise children, especially if they're using clippers or scissors. Create or help them create their own little area. Consider a small cutting garden or a fern bed in which to play with their toy dinosaur. Encourage help by putting money in the till. Don't forget the time-honored tradition of paying your budding entrepreneurs for pulling weeds and picking off bugs, though the going rate is probably no longer a penny a dandelion. Skip to Chapter 22 for some fun gardening projects for kids. Establishing a good garden for pets. Contrary to popular belief, pets and gardens are compatible. All you need is some creativity to accommodate both of them. However, because the animal is part of your life, you have to consider meeting her needs a given when setting out to lay out your yard and garden. Your biggest concern may be where your pets do their business. Dog and cat urine can create brown spots in lawns, mostly due to ammonia and uric acid in the urine, especially when the pet is a creature of habit and returns to the same spot over and over again. Just water the area to dilute, and the problem should go away. Dusting the area with gypsum can also help to neutralize the urine. Warning: either bury or scoop pet poop. Your decision. Just never add this waste to a compost pile or spot where edible plants are growing, because cats and dogs aren't vegetarians, and meat waste products don't belong there. Pet feces can contain harmful bacteria, parasites, or other disease-causing organisms. Warning: if you have pets, be careful about the gardening products you use and where you store them. Plan to keep the critters indoors after fertilizing or spraying until the packaging says it's safe. You may also want to consider what you choose to grow and where you plant it. If animals eat a plant that doesn't agree with them, up it comes, on your living room floor. In some cases, a trip to the vet may be in order. Visit the Animal Poison Control Center website, aspca.org, for more information. Designing a dog-friendly garden. If you have a dog or dogs, design your garden with the following in mind. Water to drink. Place a large bowl of fresh water in a spot where your dog can get direct access to it without trampling through valued plants, and where no humans will step on it. Replenish the water often, because it may collect debris, dry up, or get too warm if in the sun. Shade to rest in. Your dog may have her own ideas about which shrubs or trees to rest under, but you can influence your pooch's decision by trimming away lower branches so scooting into the spot is easier. You can also create and fill in a sand beach area, which also allows unfettered and non-destructive digging, if your pooch is a digging sort. If you want to have a fenced-in dog-run area, Make sure it has sheltering shade throughout the day in some part, and that the run is in a spot where you can see and or hear your pet, so you don't forget about your four-legged friend. Dogs don't like to do their business in the same place where they rest or play, so the run needs to be big enough to allow for both activities. Plants in tall containers. This puts the plants out of range of most dogs. Grasses that are more urine tolerant. Bermuda grass holds up well. Making your garden cat friendly. Outdoor cats need clean, cool water too, and they also like the sanctuary of a safe, shady spot where they can observe undetected or undisturbed. Watch where they go, and improve it for them, if you can, with extra protection, like their own small, simple cat house, and more space. Note: a garden with sand isn't a great idea if you have cats. They'll think it's an outdoor litter box. Sometimes cats use tree trunks as scratching posts. Little trees can't tolerate this abuse of their outer bark, so rig a collar of tape, chicken wire, or hardware cloth to prevent the damage. Creating space for entertainment. A popular trend these days is outdoor rooms or outdoor living, and it's easy to see why. When good weather comes, who can resist hanging out or dining in the fresh air? Patio gardens, decks, and terraces adjacent to the house, front, side, or back, continue to be popular because you and your guests have easy access to the house. People can easily pop inside for additional food, drink, or supplies, to use the restroom, or to dispose of trash. Screened-in spots may be necessary if you have a mosquito or other bug problem and still want to be comfortable outside. For ideas on container gardens for patios, see Chapter 19. Tip: if you want to place the focal point farther from the house, such as at a gazebo or under a pergola or in a poolside entertaining area, make sure it's well stocked with beverages and snacks to spare yourself long treks back and forth to the house. Place it close to electrical outlets for lighting possibilities and water for cleaning up. Outdoor storage units and shelves should do the trick. You can find a wide array of outdoor furniture options, styles, as well as materials, from rust-resistant tables, chairs, and benches, to mildew-resistant cushions in bright colors, to handsome but practical umbrellas. You can have a set that looks great, even when left out in the sun and rain. Just feast your eyes on the choices at your local home supply store, big box retail store, or mail-order gardening supplier. The outdoor lifestyle has never offered so many excellent and attractive choices. Choose stuff that meets your needs, is durable, and has style and color that match or enhance or set the tone for the surrounding garden. You may also invest in attractive fitted covers for everything to protect items from the elements when not in use. Outdoor entertainment areas ought to connect to the garden, so that although people are enjoying indoor-style comforts and amenities, people are still able to savor the unique joys of being outside. You can incorporate potted plants, both colorful flowers and practical herbs or veggies, set out vases of flowers cut from the garden, add hanging baskets, and plant right up to the perimeters. To create a transition from the outdoor entertainment area and the garden proper, and thus gracefully blend them, repeat elements in both places. Use the same or similar plants, or incorporate the same or complementary colors. Complementary colors, red and green, blue and orange, and purple and yellow, are across from each other on the color wheel. Add flair and beauty to your outdoor entertaining area with wind chimes, candles, citronella torches, lanterns, or wind socks. Remember. Whatever you decide to set up, remember to imagine and then accommodate foot traffic. People will wear a path anyway, so plan for it. Designing a sanctuary. A garden retreat needs to be outside and away from the busy world, where you can relax and gather your thoughts in peace, quiet, and solitude. In a sense, any garden can provide retreat for the world-weary, nerve-jangled gardener. But some backyard retreats are more soothing than others. Having a simple and undemanding landscape and decor can encourage you to relax, not jump up to attend to garden chores or errant weeds. Plants with relaxing colors of blue, green, and pastels also help set the mood. You needn't turn your entire garden to a zen-like space, but you could. A special corner or tucked-away nook will do. Privacy, protection, and isolation are key elements of a good retreat. Think about adding a fence or wall to block out sights, and equally importantly, sounds. Less solid screens in the shape of trellises or tall and dense plantings of trees and shrubs, or even a gathering of potted plants can also enclose a space. The idea is to make a garden room accessible yet insulated. For summertime relaxation, consider a shady retreat. Within the walls of your retreat, make a comfortable place to sit or even recline. A full table and chairs set is appropriate if you plan to share the space and enjoy meals or quiet cups of tea here. A hammock or a chaise lounge invites reading and relaxing. Now, consider the furnishings, namely plants and decor. Choose plants that don't require fussing. For shade, try impatiens or ferns. For sun, marigolds or zinnias are good choices. Stick to a simple or even monochromatic color scheme, one that's soothing to the eye. Consider a water element, such as a small, tubbed water garden or fountain. The inherently soothing sight and sound of water can help block out distracting noises. Units now on the market work on solar energy and don't require electric hookups. See Chapter 20 for water garden ideas. Personalize the space. A judiciously employed ornament, such as a hummingbird feeder, a large clay urn, a garden statue of Saint Fiacre, the patron saint of gardeners, Buddha, or an interesting rock can further the mood. Use simple ornaments that have meaning to you and are in keeping with your theme. Cooking up an edible garden. If you love to cook and enjoy gardening, it's only a matter of time before you long to grow your own produce. A so-called kitchen garden can be modest in size, easy to manage, and produce all the fresh vegetables and herbs you desire. It doesn't need to be extensive or as ambitious as a back 40 vegetable garden. For help with such a large garden, skip to Chapter 15, remembering that it may require more space and it will require full sun. Because a kitchen garden exists for one reason, to generate good things to eat, planting it near your house is best. That way, you can pop out the door, snip the herbs you need, or grab a few sun-warmed cherry tomatoes and put them to immediate use. Ideally, a kitchen or dining room window overlooks your patch, so you aren't likely to forget what's ripe for the taking. Setting up your garden for international cuisine. Consider what kinds of cuisine you like to cook, and you can prepare yourself for an international feast with some of the freshest possible ingredients. Chinese. Try long beans, Chinese broccoli, Chinese cabbage, water spinach, and bok choy. Indian. Opt for various herbs and leafy greens, plus certain kinds of eggplant and onions. Italian. Be sure to include tomatoes, oregano, and basil, at the least. Mexican. The easy herb cilantro is a must, as is epazote, and of course a salsa medley of tomatoes, onions, garlic, and various peppers, hot and mild. If your goal is to serve healthier and fresher food to your family, go for a variety of classic vegetables and herbs. Even salad skeptics may be won over after they taste a wondrous array of colorful lettuces accompanied by fresh, ripe tomatoes. And kids who don't normally enjoy vegetables can discover the joys of fresh, sweet, homegrown peas and carrots. For more on raising vegetables, consult Chapter 15. I cover herbs in Chapter 17. The easiest, most successful kitchen gardens are small and simple. You can always expand later. To start, I recommend keeping it sunny. At least 6 hours of full sun per day is essential for good growth and ripening of almost all vegetables, herbs, and edible flowers. Morning light is preferable to afternoon because it dries the dew, reducing the risk of disease, and is less stressful than the blazing heat of mid-afternoon. Setting the boundaries. Stake out a spot using string rigged between wooden sticks, or try a simpler approach. Use your garden hose as a guide. After you establish the garden, you can edge the bed with bricks or stones or commercial edging. Plastic edging is cheaper, but quickly becomes brittle when exposed to full sun. Steel edging is a much better choice and will last a long time. Or dig a roughly 4-inch deep, 10-centimeter trench around all the edges. The idea is to keep any lawn grass from encroaching on your kitchen garden. Building raised beds. If the soil in the appointed spot isn't very good, erect a raised bed from planks standing on edge. Be sure to use untreated lumber, because some wood preservatives may be harmful to edible plants. Unless you use the more expensive cedar, these wooden sides will eventually rot and need replacing. Composite lumber, that is a mixture of wood fiber, plastic, and some type of binding agent, is another option. These ingredients are bonded together to form a material that is denser, stronger, and heavier than wood alone, and makes it extremely resistant to insect damage and rot. See Chapter 15 for info on raised beds. Installing protective barriers. If you garden in deer, woodchuck, or rabbit territory, just to name some of the worst pests, or if you host backyard soccer games, a protective fence around your kitchen garden may be in order. Use poultry wire or wood and sink it into the ground to discourage digging invaders. If the fence doesn't look very attractive, plant fast-growing, lightweight plants to cover it, such as morning glories and moonflowers. Planting a few containers that are literally at the kitchen door. Try a small tomato plant surrounded by spicy globe basil, a cut-and-come-again mix of lettuces and salad greens, and another container of your favorite herbs. Zeroing in on your ideal garden style. After you've determined your basic wants and needs for your garden space, you're ready to decide on its overall style. Gardens come in many types, themes, and moods. Yours can be informal, with less strict boundaries, a more casual look, and a wide variety of plants. Or it can be formal, with symmetrical lines, crisp edges, and a limited plant palette. Or it can be one of the many variations in between. Select a style based on the architecture of your house, the lay of the land, or even an idea you saw in a magazine or online. Your choice also ought to take into consideration the advantages and disadvantages already inherent in your yard and gardening space, as I outline in the first half of the chapter. Remember, a garden is an emotional place for many people, a place of pride and joy, of relaxation, comfort, and meaningful projects. It may contain favorite plants of loved ones. Luckily, a garden's always a work in progress, and you can improve, expand, or totally change some or all of it over time. You should also be open to surprises, like the errant sunflower that pops up near the deck, or the herb that self-sows into the roses and ends up looking pretty there. So, dream and plan, but be flexible. One of life's greatest pleasures is just puttering in the garden with no particular mission in mind and discovering something new or unexpected. Gardening around a theme. Garden design often goes beyond the types of plants you want to grow and the type of function you want your garden to have. Thematic elements can also influence the look of a garden. Do you have a soft spot for old-fashioned English rose gardens, or Japanese Zen gardens, or even sandy deserts filled with cacti and succulents? In the following sections, I list some popular style elements to help you continue clarifying what you may want and need. Remember, if you want your garden to be like the styles in this book, or any other of the large variety of garden styles available, be sure to do plenty of research beforehand to make your space look as harmonious and authentic as possible. And don't forget to make sure your space can accommodate the style. Trying to install an outdoor cactus garden in the Midwest, USA, may not be your best bet. Formal gardens. Keep formal gardens simple. See Figure 2-1. Aim for balance and symmetry so the garden has an air of calm elegance. Here are some tips. Use strong lines and boundaries, such as groomed hedges, walkways, perhaps even a reflecting pool. Employ single-color plantings, aiming to match or complement your house color, fence, or another element. Add stylish pots, urns, gazing balls, or statuary. Keep everything in moderation so it doesn't look cluttered. Japanese gardens. Japanese gardens, refer to Figure 2-2, are usually based on a garden floor, or a broad area of raked sand or stones. Choose fine-textured traditional plants in pots or in the ground. Try bamboo, dwarf conifers, Japanese maples, iris, azalea, and flowering fruit trees. Then include Asian-style accessories such as stone lanterns, bamboo fencing, a water basin, or even a small tea house. When you choose plants for a Japanese garden, think small. Using dwarf varieties of plants can help keep the garden in scale. Tropical garden. Put a piece of paradise in your own backyard. Tropical gardens, check out Figure 2-3, emphasize lots of big, bold, leafy foliage plants, such as cannas, coleus, hibiscus, and taro, in the ground or in large containers. Use bright flowers in hot colors, yellow, red, and orange, as well as bicolors. Then include a water feature, such as a pool, fountain, or stream. You can add drama with extras, bird houses or cages, colorful pots, gazing balls, and playful or handcrafted decor and statuary. Cottage gardens. Cottage gardens should be overflowing with colorful blooms, so plant these inviting, informal gardens with a generous hand. Include lots of roses and other fragrant plants, including herbs. Keep the plants well tended. Remove spent flowers and stems, but allow them to express their natural exuberance. Finally, add some charming touches. A picket fence, an arbor, whimsical birdhouses, or wind chimes. Dry climate gardens. If your area is a little on the parched side, you may want to opt for a dry climate garden. Employ a naturalistic layout, perhaps with a dry stream bed or stone pathways, and choose plants that thrive in hot sun, including but not limited to cacti and succulents. Then strategically place accents of colorful or more water-needy plants in pots or in groups. Woodland gardens. Woodland gardens, which are often shady, include ground covers that flower, as well as bulbs, for lots of spring color. For fall color, you can plant some native asters. This garden is most practical if you already have a well-treed lot. Tall, deciduous hardwoods like oaks, beeches, and maples are ideal because they provide a high canopy with diffused shade. Seek out diverse forms and colors for the larger plants, from bold hostas to lacy ferns. Then, you can tuck in non-plant items for color and interest, such as ornaments and garden furniture. Perusing sources for inspired ideas. As part of your narrowing down process, have fun as you gather inspiration. Here are some great suggestions. Go online and search for photos of gardens. You can look for home garden designs or search specifically for types of gardens you want to create. You can also check out Facebook, Pinterest, and Instagram for more ideas in their garden forums. Thumb through back issues of gardening magazines and flag beautiful photographs and helpful articles. Grab a few of those arguably fluffy gardening magazines you often see at the checkout stand at the grocery store or home improvement store. Technically, they're called SIPs, or special interest publications. These publications tend to be heavily photo-driven, lighter on the actual how-to information, but that's the dreamy stuff you want right now. Check the gardening books you already own, both practical ones and coffee table books, and do the same. Visit a well-stocked bookstore or the book section at a garden center and do some more prospecting. Look in your library. Your library can be a super source for garden design books. You can skim through a lot of them without paying a penny. After you find a few useful titles, buy them. Visit the gardens, including public parks, botanical gardens, and arboreta that aren't too far beyond your front door. Take some photos with either your phone or camera. Walk around surrounding neighborhoods and take pictures of gardens or vignettes that pique your interest. Many neighborhoods and master gardener programs sponsor local garden tours that are great for idea shopping, and you can usually talk directly with the garden makers to pick their brains. If your city parks department takes care of the city parks, walk through them for inspiration as well. The object of this exercise is to fill your mind with enticing images of what's possible. You also get to see how other gardeners, in various regions with different types of yards, have pulled off their woodland garden or cottage garden or whatever you're aiming for. Study their creativity and their solutions. They can help you clarify your vision. Keeping your budget in mind. Having a good garden or a series of smaller gardens on your property does cost money. Fencing materials and paving stones aren't cheap. Garden furnishings and decor aren't cheap. Big plants, special small plants and pots aren't cheap. Potting soil and loam aren't cheap. Fertilizer and pesticides aren't cheap. It all adds up. And frankly, budgeting is hard when you're dealing with an ongoing project whose look is likely to evolve. So here's my main advice. Relax. Rome wasn't built in a day. Take small bites if need be. Tackle one project at a time and see it through, and then move on to the next one. Or divide a large project into sections and allow yourself time, even several seasons or years, to complete it. One place where you can save money is labor. Use yourself. Involve your partner or your kids. Bribe friends with dinner. Or hire neighborhood kids. And remember that fortunately, gardening is one of those experiences in life whose journey can be as satisfying as the destination. Tip: here are some other money-saving ideas. Grow plants from seed. See Chapter 10 for much more information on this. Divide perennials and shrubs and move the pieces to other parts of your yard. See Chapter 7 for info on how to divide perennials. Get plants from other gardeners. Some people may simply give you their unwanted surplus. Others will be happy to swap. Join a local garden club, and you may be assured of these transactions. Make your own compost. See Chapter 4 for tips. And always compost your fall leaves instead of bagging them and sending them off to the local landfill. Buy from the source or grower, whether it's a special daylily nursery nearby or a local brickyard. Browse yard sales, junkyards, and antique shops. You may happen across real bargains in garden ornaments, as well as pots, gates, trellises, fencing, and so on. Last but not least, take care of your investments. It's a sad waste to let good, costly plants or garden areas languish or die. The more you know about soil, about planting, about plant care, and this book is chock full of useful advice, the easier it'll be to do right by your garden. A thriving garden can repay you many times over. Bringing your garden ideas to reality. Now's the time to start getting real. Armed with your ideas and goals and wishes, step outside and bring your plans to life. Some gardeners find that the best time to do this step is fall or winter, when you have fewer distractions from overgrown plants and seasonal clutter. The outline and the bones of a yard are more evident then. But whenever you do this step, look beyond what's present. Visualize what will change and what will go in. When you're ready to sketch out your garden plan, you can do it yourself, or if it seems daunting or is simply not your cup of tea, you can hire a licensed professional. Your overall garden plan doesn't have to be precise or perfect. It just has to do what you need it to do. Show you your yard so you can plan what you want to put into it. Computer-aided design, embracing your inner garden architect.
Once the province. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.